Hello, anatomy friends. This is Dr. Alsup, and we are talking about one of my all-time favorite things, cranial fossae. This is one of the videos that will have considerable overlap with the dissection supplement covering the same topic, and this is super on purpose. We will go a bit more into the concepts in this particular video, whereas the dissection supplement will be more about how we plan to identify these things in a practical setting. Use these opportunities of overlap to find those areas that you need to spend a bit more time reviewing and really focus on those. If you have something down pat, don't spend as much time there. All right, so let's get started with all this fun. As mentioned before, we will focus on the cranial fossae, of which there are three. There is the anterior, the middle, and the posterior cranial fossae. We will talk about where these are located, and importantly, what are the important foramina or passageways of neurovasculature associated with the crania. Okay, we are looking at a superior view of the cranial base in this particular image. So the cranial base also can be referred to as the basal cranium, with the shaded portions depicting the divisions of the basal cranium into these fossae, or these cranial fossae. The light blue here is depicting the anterior cranial fossa, which is bounded by the squama of the frontal bone, so the frontal bone right here, and it will extend to the lesser wing of the sphenoid, so into this region here. There's variation depending on sources regarding how far it will extend medially in this region. For our purposes, we are including the anterior clinoid processes as well as the optic strut. So we're going all the way to this medial portion here. The anterior cranial fossa holds the inferior and anterior parts of the frontal lobe. This gray portion here is representing the middle cranial fossa. This will include the inferior portions of the lesser wings of the sphenoid, to the apex, or kind of the top region, of the petrous part of the temporal bone. The temporal lobes and portions of the pituitary gland, which will sit in this region, will sit here. Last but not least, the yellow portion of this image indicates the expanse that is the posterior cranial fossa, which is extending from the apex of the petrous part of the temporal bone to the squamous portions of the occipital bone. This is the deepest of the fossae, because I hope you can notice here that these fossae are organized in a very stair-step fashion. So this is the highest step, this would be the lowest step. And one other thing I really hope you've noticed is that there are a lot of foramina, or holes in these regions. These are passageways for neurovasculature to enter or exit, in fact mostly exit, the skull. And during development, bone is going to form around this neurovasculature. So the bone will form after the neurovasculature. So these areas will vary in size and shape dependent on what is traversing the foramina. So if something is big, then the foramen will be comparatively bigger. If it's a big vein like we have, say, with the internal jugular vein, you will have an oddly shaped foramen, kind of like you have here with the jugular foramen. So let's talk about some of these foramina, and most importantly in this video, we're going to focus on what traverses these areas. As we often do in anatomy, let's start anterior and work our way posterior. One note before we get started, I highly, highly recommend you make your own set of tables or charts or whatever works best for you. The act of doing this on your own and not just memorizing something we've already written out for you will really help with this area. Trust me here. So figure out what works for you, but do it on your own. All right, so when we are in the anterior cranial fossa, you are focusing on three bones. You have your frontal bone here. This area that I'm about to outline here is your ethmoid, and then you have your sphenoid bone here. So those are the three main bones. There is quite a bit happening in this ethmoid region here, and comparatively less happening in the other regions. Here you have these very distinctive small foramina all over the place here. These are the cribriform or meaning sieve-like foramina. And axons of the olfactory cells are going to ascend from the nasal regions to form the olfactory nerves, which is your cranial nerve 1. These foramina are surrounding the crista galli, which you can see kind of projecting right here, which is the anterior attachment site for the fossa cerebri. There are also going to be the optic canals in this region. Note, you will often see these optic canals as part of the middle cranial fossa in other resources. Again, we are going by schemes described in Gray's Anatomy. Don't get too bogged down there. But what I really want you to understand is what is going to traverse the optic canals, which are going to be both the ophthalmic arteries, which is the main arterial supply for the optic region or the orbital region, and the optic nerve, which is cranial nerve 2. All right, there is a lot going on in the middle cranial fossa, particularly with this superior orbital fissure, which is difficult to see in this superior view here. You can see a little bit of it right here underneath the lesser wing. You would have another one under this region here. One of the things that all of these structures, which is a lot, have in common is that they are heading for the orbit. And you can see the superior orbital fissure right here when you're looking into the orbit. You will have numerous cranial nerves that are going to be moving through this region. So we'll start with cranial nerve 3, or your oculomotor nerve, which will efferently serve 4 of the 6 extraocular eye muscles, in addition to carrying preganglionic parasympathetics. More on that one later. The trochlear nerve, or cranial nerve 4, will provide motor innervation to only 1 extraocular eye muscle, which is your superior oblique. The ophthalmic nerve, or the first division of the trigeminal nerve, will provide afferent innervation to the orbital region. The abducens nerve, or cranial nerve 6, is efferent innervation for the lateral rectus muscle, so that last extraocular eye muscle. And lastly, the ophthalmic veins will traverse the superior orbital fissure, which will drain blood from the orbital region. So like I mentioned, a lot is going on here, and this is why this fissure is comparatively larger than many of the other foramina in this region or in the orbital region, because you have so much moving through that region. Continuing with the middle cranial fossa, there are 3 more foramina I want to discuss and you are responsible for knowing. This pretty much kind of perfect little circle here is the foramen rotundum, which is the way in which V2, or the maxillary nerve, will exit the skull. The more oval-shaped and larger foramen right here is going to be the foramen ovale. The foramen ovale will allow the exit of the mandibular nerve, or the third division of the trigeminal nerve, which is your largest division of the trigeminal. Thus, you have a larger foramen than you have with the foramen rotundum. Lastly, this little pinprick of a foramen right here and right here, which is posterolateral to the foramen ovale, is the foramen spinosum, which allows the middle meningeal artery to ascend to get into the skull to supply blood to the meningeal regions. Last but not least, we have the posterior cranial fossa foramina. The internal acoustic meatus is located on the side of this petrous part of the temporal bone, or this rock-like portion of the temporal bone. And it is leading into the inner and middle ear regions that are housed within the petrous part. So the facial nerve is going to go in to the meatus, and it will eventually make its way out of the skull, whereas the vestibulocochlear nerve, or cranial nerve 8, will go into this region and never come out, which makes sense because within this petrous part of the temporal bone is the middle and inner ears. Vestibulocochlear nerve plays a major role in terms of hearing and equilibrium. Okay, one of my all-time favorite foramina are the jugular foramina, which I am outlining right here, kind of between the temporal bone and the occipital bone. You can see that there is a divot of bone right here leading into the foramen. This is where the sigmoid sinus sat during life, draining the brain and leading into the jugular foramen. Once you get to the jugular foramen, you have a name change and you have the beginnings of the internal jugular vein, or your IJV. Additionally, three cranial nerves will exit the skull here. You'll have glossopharyngeal nerve, or cranial nerve 9, the vagus nerve, or cranial nerve 10, you know all about that one at this point, and then the accessory nerve, or cranial nerve 11, which is going to innervate your sternocleidomastoid and trapezius muscles. The most obvious foramen here is the foramen magnum. This big one right here, this is actually the second largest foramen of the body. The largest is way down in the hip region. It is here that you have that transition from the medulla oblongata to the spinal cord. So you have that change occurring there. You also have the accessory nerve, or cranial nerve 11, which will ascend through the foramen magnum, which is odd because we just talked about this nerve in association with the jugular foramen. Well, it is associated with both. The accessory nerve, formerly referred to as the spinal accessory nerve, originates from the spinal cord. So it will come off the spinal cord and then ascend through the foramen magnum to get into the skull, and then almost immediately, so it's getting into the skull, and then almost immediately will exit the skull via the jugular foramen. The vertebral arteries will also ascend through the foramen magnum to be a major supplier of blood to the brain. And lastly, the anterior and posterior spinal arteries will move through the foramen magnum in order to provide blood supply to the spinal cord. Lastly, the hypoglossal canals are a little bit more difficult to identify. They're kind of hiding right here. They're closely associated to the foramen magnum. It is through these canals that the hypoglossal nerves, or cranial nerves 12, will exit the skull. All right, let's assess our knowledge in this area with a question. So the question is, neurovasculature traversing the superior orbital fissure are heading towards which region, or what region? A, nasal cavity, B, oral cavity, C, orbit, D, pterygopalatine fossa. Take your time here because this is a really important concept I hope that we've caught on to. And once you're ready, I hope that you have landed on the fact that C is the correct answer. Hopefully this helped out quite a bit, kind of telling you what it is, but neurovasculature traversing the superior orbital fissure, as well as the optic canals, are communicating with the orbit. The cribriform foramina are communicating with the nasal cavity region, and the other two areas we didn't get into as much here, the oral cavity and the pterygopalatine fossa, but I promise we will spend quite a bit of time in these regions in the future. So that is what we have today regarding the cranial fossae and associated neurovasculature. Please always feel free to reach out with questions, and please have an excellent day.